You're the active speaker.
I'm the active speaker, he said.
Yes. Okay. The problem is if there's any sound from any of them, that's why we mute everybody.
Okay. No so sound, anybody.
Please mute.
Please mute. Okay. Anyhow, having said all of the above, the church will open July 19th, and we'll let you know all the ramifications, all the guidelines a little later on. Tuesday morning, we're going to have worship here at our house for 10 people. Whoever signs up and wants to come, it won't be on Zoom, but it'll be at 10 o'clock in the morning here at my house. So if you want to attend, let me know. First 10 can come. And then on Thursday at 10 o'clock, we have the prayer meeting always every Thursday. Let's see. I want you to know that we have given out $10,000 of your money for various food banks in the community. So thank you for your donations. And when you send your donation, send it to Roy Stedman. And we will continue using it to feed the people in this area. So that's a praise and a thanksgiving. So let's open with prayer. Almighty God, we just come to you with thankful hearts and positive hearts and sometimes stressful hearts. Father, you have given us a mission here in this community and in our church, and we thank you for that. And we pray that you send your Holy Spirit to empower us to do your work here, to be your hands and feet. We thank you for that gift of Jesus, the gift of salvation and forgiveness of sin and life for all eternity. We pray for those who have special needs, who are facing health issues right now, and they are many, too many to name all of them, but just take a minute and sign up prayer and pray for those who have health issues. Hear our prayer, O Lord, and we know that you do. Now bless our gathering today. Bless the donations that have been given to us and the giver and the recipients of that monetary gift. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are delighted to have Jerry Jones with us this morning. So I'm going to ask him to come forward now and sing for us.
Good morning. We're glad to be here this morning. Of course, we're glad to be anywhere this morning. So there's a lot of things that we go through, but one thing we always know, that God is with us and he's holding our hand.
That's number one. Would always be me. I thought that I could be who I wanted to be. I thought that I could build on life's sinking sand, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I thought that I could do a lot on my own. I thought that I could make it. As a mighty big man, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, I can't even walk without
Blessed by that, like I've been blessed by that. You could just feel the Holy Spirit coming from that man's voice. God has used him in a wonderful, wonderful way. And there are many of us that have had tough walking, and we can't do it without holding his hand. Those with health issues, those that are affected by the coronavirus, those who have been having racial problems going on, we need to walk holding his hand. Now we're blessed this morning to have Bill with us. And Bill, I'm going to turn this over to you now. Thank you for your willingness to preach from way up north. God bless you, Bill.
Good morning, everyone. I just want to take a brief moment to thank everybody for their prayers, their concerns, their phone calls, their emails, while I've been at home, and for the cards as well. Just to give you a brief update, I do have to have a conference with the neurosurgeon on Friday, so most likely it looks like I'll be having back surgery again. So the title of my message this morning is Worry Gets You Nowhere. Let's open with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you modeled for us what it means to be a father. We thank you that you've taught our fathers what it means to love, what it means to care for, what it means to nurture their children. We thank you, Lord, for the fathers that we were given. We thank you, Lord, for our fathers and the children that we have. May we raise them to be godly men and godly women. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, Lord Jesus, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The word worry means to allow your mind while on troubles or difficulties in a repetitive uncontrollable manner. Worry is like sitting in a rocking chair and rocking. It gives you something to do, but it gets you nowhere. Do you remember the 1988 song by Bobby McFerrin titled "Don't Worry, Be Happy"? Here's some of the lyrics. In every life, you have some trouble, but when you worry, you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. And last week we heard about how the Israelites were shaken in their boots at Goliath and how they were worried and how they were scared. But this is just a reminder that our God is bigger than any of the giants that we face in our life. So why worry? Our text this morning is going to be Psalm 37, verses 1 through 7. But before I start, I just want to let you know that the word fret means to constantly or visibly be worried or anxious. Beginning at verse 1, do not fret when wicked men seem to succeed. Do not envy evildoers, for they will quickly dry up like the grass and wither away like plants. Trust in the Lord and do what is right. Settle in the land and maintain your integrity. Then you will take delight in the Lord, and he will answer your prayers. Commit your future to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act on your behalf. He will vindicate you in broad daylight and publicly defend your just cause. Wait patiently for the Lord. Wait confidently for him. Do not fret over the apparent success of a sinner or a man who carries out wicked schemes. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today's scripture points out that there are four things that we need to do to overcome worry. The first thing we need to do is to trust in the Lord. In verse 3, it tells us to trust in the Lord and do what is good. Dwell in the land and maintain your integrity. Do you trust God for your salvation, or are you still relying on your own self? Are you worried sick over COVID-19 or financial matters or health issues or civil unrest we see in our streets? Or have you given them over to God? Here are some things that you can do to build trust in the Lord. Number one, build a relationship with God. Get to know him better. The more time you spend in God's word and praying, the closer you will become and closer you will get to God. Continually monitor your thoughts and your feelings. The Bible tells us to take every thought captive. Think of the positive and do not dwell on the negative. Saturate your heart and your mind with the Word of God, and spend time daily talking to God. Talking to God as if you're talking to a friend. The best example of this that I can tell you about is from the movie Fiddler on the Roof. Tevye, the main character of the movie, continually has a conversation with God throughout the movie. Sometimes it's humorous, sometimes it's serious, but still, he has this ongoing conversation. And that's an example of how we Christians today should pray to God. We need to pray to God like we're talking to a friend. Replace your negative thoughts and feelings with the promises of God. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." Now, we talk about the promises of God. We even sing a song, Standing on the Promises of God. But what are the promises of God? Well, here are 10 promises from God taken directly from the Bible. Number one, God promises to strengthen you. Number two, God promises to give you rest. Number three, God promises to take care of your needs, not your wants. Number four, God promises to answer your prayers. Number five, God promises to work everything out for you. Number six, God promises to be with you. Number seven, God promises to protect you. Number eight, God promises you freedom from sin. Number nine, God promises that nothing can separate you from Him. And number 10, God promises to give you eternal life. These promises prove that God is with us and that God is for us. So replace your negative thoughts and your negative feelings with these promises from God. The second thing we need to do is to delight in the Lord. Verse 4 says, "Then you will take delight in the Lord, and He will answer your prayers." Now, the word delight means to enjoy or to give great pleasure. It's like the loving relationship between a husband and a wife. You need to see God as the greatest, the most admirable, the most important being in the entire universe. Delight in God as your Savior and your personal friend. Delight in His love, His care, His protection that He gives each and every one of us. Delight in God through the gifts that He has given us. Everything that we have in this life is a gift from God, and we need to have an attitude of gratitude for the gifts that we have been given. In Psalm 37, verse 23, the Bible urges us to desire God's will, to enjoy His word and His presence, because they guard our every step. The third thing that we need to do is commit your way. Are you dedicated to following Jesus? Verse 5 tells us, "Commit your future to the Lord. Trust in Him, and He will act on your behalf." In Acts chapter 27, where Paul is at sea, he's on his way to Rome, and he's caught in a hellacious storm. Paul demonstrates that it's more than just a verbal affirmation, because commitment means forsaking all other avenues, like cutting the ropes that hold the lifeboats when you're faced with perishing in a storm at sea, like Paul faced. Commitment is like the story of the chicken and the pig. They wanted to give the king a nice breakfast of bacon and eggs. For the chicken, it was just a mere contribution of a few eggs. No big deal. She could lay more eggs. However, for the pig, it was total commitment. It was a total sacrifice. He had to give everything that he had, his life, so that the king could have bacon and eggs for breakfast. So remember, when it comes to God, be a pig, not a chicken. Most of us, when we go to church, leave our burdens at the altar. However, after the church service, we keep going back to the altar to pick these things back up again. Stop doing that. Turn your burdens over to the Lord once and for all. There's no sense in both you and God being concerned about a problem. Let God handle it. And finally, the fourth thing we need to do is to rest in the Lord. In verses 6 and 7 of our text says, "He will vindicate you in broad daylight and publicly defend your just cause. Wait patiently for the Lord. Wait confidently for him. Do not fret over anything." In Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, this Bible passage teaches us that resting in the Lord reduces anxiety, and it gives us a peace that transcends all understanding. Resting in the Lord frees our energy to be more productive for the Lord, and it takes away any unnecessary stress from our life. And we all know that we could do with a little less stress in our lives these days. So how do you find rest in the Lord? You do so by casting your cares upon God. Form a partnership with God. Seek God first instead of as a last resort after everything else you have tried has failed. You do so by releasing your burdens. Give up worrying and reasoning and anxiety and enter into a time of rest with simple childlike faith. Remember that we live by grace through faith in God. You do so by surrendering your will. Give up your ego. Give up always wanting to have things your way. Surrendering to God's will helps you to obtain rest. And you will know that you have reached this rest when you trust God to work out all the issues facing you. Placing these issues in God's hands alone and allowing God to deal with these issues in his own time. You do so by knowing that you are loved. God loves us unconditionally, no matter what. His love never fluctuates. Romans chapter 8, verse 5 says, "While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." That's unconditional love. God is love, and he loves each and every one of us. So by finding hope, we need to find hope before we can find peace. Hope is the assurance that God cares for us and will provide for us moving forward. You do so by surrendering your will and your dreams. Allow God to take control of them. Allow God's rest to become more of an active part of your life. In conclusion, there is no reason why a child of God should ever be consumed with worry. To worry is to doubt God. Do you doubt God? Can any one of us add an hour to our life by worrying? Now, here's your takeaway for the week. Remember that the things we worry about are like a twig to an elephant when we place them in God's hands. In our hands, they seem insurmountable. But in God's hands, they really are no big deal. Amen. Let us pray. Our God and Heavenly Father, help us to trust you always. Help us to delight in you. Lord, help us to commit to your way, not our own way. Help us to rest in you. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Bill, for that very important message during this time in our individual lives and in our corporate lives and in the world's life. Thank you for that message. Now we're having Jerry Jones come back and sing a closing song for us.
Back.
No. Good morning. I thought I had it ready to go, but evidently I wasn't. We sometimes wonder if God hears us, but he hears us all the time. No matter how many prayers are sent up, he hears us.
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came to dwell among the lowly, such as I, suffer shame and such disgrace, at Mount Calvary take my place. And I ask myself this question, who am I? Who am I that would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thy Lord? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so. And to that old rugged cross he'd go. Who am I? When I think of the words he said, I'll leave you never. If you be true, I'll give to you life forever. What could I have ever done to deserve God's only Son? Fight my battles until they're won, or who am I? Who am I that would bleed and die for? have I that he would pray, not my will thy Lord. Answer I may never know, for why he ever loved me so. But to that old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I? But to that old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
Oh, we're always so blessed to have him come sing for us. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and give you peace as you claim his promises this week. Put your hand in his hand. He's reaching down, but you have to reach up. God bless each one of you. Amen. And unmute. Come on in.
Hey, Audrey and Bill. Good morning.
I forgot to sing yet. Mm-hmm. Oh, they're so good.
Oh, wonderful, yeah. Message.
So one camera.
Okay.
Oh, you don't. Hey, Lisa.
Oh, my goodness.
Hi, Lou.
Hey, Audrey, how are you?
You never called me back.
Uh-oh.
Okay, my turn. I'm a got something.
No,
good. So, yeah. Roy Dorsey, will you lead us? And God is so good.
I come to God is so good.
You're assuming I can sing this morning. Excuse me.
We're with you.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. He loves us all. He loves us all. He loves us all. He's so good to me.
Of God's children said, amen.
Amen.
Smiling.
Keep smiling.
I think
that
was. Hi, Steve.
Different times, but that's wonderful.
Hey, Bill, that was a very good sermon today. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Jay.
Yes, Bill. Very good.
Thank you. So good.
We look forward to hearing many more from you.
Okay.
Yeah. And we'll be praying for you this week.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Hope you get the returns that you want on for your surgery.
What's that?
I said I hope you get good results that you have to have surgery.
Thank you very much.
Yes, please keep us updated.
I will.
You know.
When you come back next fall, I'll have a gift for you, a Vikings cup.
That's okay. Hey, you know what? I'll use it.
How about a Steelers cup?
Well,
I don't know about that. Let's not go too far.
Let's not go too far, Mo.
Hey, Carol.
Never seen it.
Hi, Linda.
Okay.
Hey, Barb.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye, guys.
Hey, Ruth, are you still there?
God bless you. I love you.
I dream week.
Ruth, God, are you still there?
I got a message for Norma.
Hi, Janet.
I know.
Norma. Hi. How are you?
Okay. Your sister Jerry's leaving us.
Leaving? What does that mean? Going just north?
She's going to Tennessee.
Not forever.
She sold her house. Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
I heard
that. Wow. Who did?
Jerry Sledge.
She left yesterday.
That's Norma's sister.
Yes. Now I'm going to have to move to Tennessee. I'll get a new sister. Maybe you can be my sister.
Okay. Mama, Jerry. Jerry is Norma's sister.
Just kidding. They always say we look alike. They think we're each other.
They're alike.
You're looking beautiful as ever.